Well, before making some remarks about the Spanish transition process and whether or not we can derive some ideas, let me tell you that I'm in favor of thinking that, you know, any process of transition can give insights, ideas, but not recipes for other transition processes. So, if we divide the history of the transition process like Huntington in waves, well, there was a wave, in which wave Spain was one of the cases, where almost all the countries move from the situation of military dictatorship to a democratic situation. The Spanish was a case, but even Portugal was another case in these waves. Our neighbor countries are very different in the process. In Portugal was the army who triggered the process towards the democracy, and in Spain one of the problems of the transition was the control by the government of the army during the process. So after this wave we had another one, the countries of the east of Europe. Here there was a common feature, a common characteristic, the mix of the Communist Party and the highest officers in the army, in the armed forces, but again very different situations. Now with the Arab Spring I'm afraid that we are again with such different situations that there are no recipes at all. This English sentence, one size fits all, it's completely impossible. Tunisia is a very particular example with possibilities of final transition and even consolidation of the transition. Egypt is a completely different situation with the armed forces controlling the situation, not now, since the 50s in the past century, and with very, very difficult prospects of any change in the foreseeable future. In Libya, it's not the army, it's the lack of the army what could be the problem. So we have to address very different situations, but let me, I've prepared six ideas that we could draw from the Spanish example or the Spanish case that even today could help us to reflect on each of these cases. I'm thinking a more similar case is Turkey, but even in Turkey things have changed in 15 years. 15 years ago I was invited in Turkey only to talk about the problem of the control of the military. Later was the court, the structuration of the country with the court minority was a priority. Now the totalitarian tendencies of Erdogan could be a major problem for the Turks and not the situation of the army. But looking at the Spanish process and giving some ideas that can be useful. The first one is that, well, I like to use the expression security sector reform, not only the military. Has a consolidated expression. Even the OECD produced a good manual, a good textbook on security sector reform. The first lesson of the Spanish process is that security sector reform is impossible if there is not a general transition process. So to try to reform only the military or only the police is doomed to the failure. It's not a possibility in any situation. Hmm? You can tell me, well, but we can be in a vicious cycle. Hmm? There is no security sector reform because there is no good transition process, and because there is no transition process, there is no security sector reform. That could be the vicious cycle of Egypt, for instance. Hmm? Fortunately, we had no vicious cycle in Spain for many reasons. I want not to detail all the reasons, but one was the existence of a monarchy, a king. And the military had to have allegiance to the king. And when the king gave support to the reform, that was one very important factor for the compliance, for the acceptance of the military of the reform process. In other countries, this positive factor is not existent. Mm-hmm. But again, let's be sure that we are in a transition, in a general transition process, before trying any reform in the security sector. Because if we start from the security sector, we risk to damage or to even to destroy a possible process of transition. Hmm? The second remark. In Spain, we had the two sub-periods. We could divide the security sector reform or the transition to democracy in the security field. I call these two periods the period of transition and the period of consolidation. In the general process, sometimes it's difficult to differentiate the end of transition, the beginning of consolidation, not in the security sector. In the security sector, the transition means that we succeed in preventing the armed forces and the police and the intelligence services to intervene in the politics of the country. That's the target of the transition period. In the consolidation period, the target is quite different. It's not to prevent the military to intervene, but to be sure that it's the government who decides in defense matters, in security matters, in intelligence matters. Hmm? In Spain, the two periods correspond to two prime ministers. The first period, transition, the leader was Adolfo Suárez, the leader in the security sector, the General Gutiérrez Mellado, and the consolidation, so to create the instruments for the government to really manage the security and defense sectors, that was the in Felipe González period as president of the government. By the way, I'll tell you that the transition started, in my opinion, in Spain by the appointment of General Gutiérrez Mellado in 1977, and the consolidation in 1983, and finished in 1989. So the whole process in Spain covered not less than 13 years. So A process of security sector reform is not short. It's not possible to design the reform of the security sector and to think that that can be done in what in the Western countries call one legislature, a normal period of elections of 4 years. Impossible. Even in Spain, that had a lot of favorable factors, the process took about 14 or 15 or 16 years. And three, Spain again, but as Portugal and Greece and all the countries of this wave, shows that only what the academicians call endogenous processes can be a success. So from outside, it's impossible to manage a reform of the security sector. Has to be the will of the government, of the society, and even has to be a priority for the government, has to imply the president of the government, and not only the Minister of Defense or the Minister of the Interior, has to be, you know, a target accepted by the government, by the parliament, that has to give support to the reform, vis-à-vis the police, vis-à-vis the armed forces, and has to be accepted by the society. If you want to assure the success, you have even to educate some journalists in security matters and to assure that you know, the criticism of the decisions, the criticism of the debates at the parliament is a good criticism by good experts. But I'm conscious that sometimes what has to be resolved is that, I'm thinking in Libya for instance, that the process of overthrowing the dictator would not destroy institutions of the state that afterwards meant that the state has no powers to control the situation. Or so the first task is the task of nation building and not the security sector reform. That could be the situation. And I think that one of the, I don't know whether what I'm going to say would be too much provoking, but that the European intervention in Libya was, in my opinion, a mistake, because Europe, at the moment of deciding the forms of intervention, was not conscious of the consequences of only a military intervention and not a larger plan, including nation building and support of the institutions working inside the country, and not only giving support to overthrow the dictator and allowing the country alone to resolve the other problems. Another remark, the security sector reform not only needs a general process of transition to democracy, but has to be a coherent process. So it would be a mistake to address only the problem of the military. In Spain, before, the police was transformed. And from a police with the objective of controlling the country to a police at the service of the citizens of the country and prevent and giving security to the citizens of the country, not controlling them but giving security to them. That was made before. So the police, the intelligence services, and even the justice at least the military justice, has to, you know, to take place if we want a security sector reform with some possibilities of success. Even, I don't know well the case, but even Tunisia, where the armed forces are not a problem for the process, well, have some, you know, the police or the acts of the police are judged in military trials, and even there can be military courts that can judge civilians. So this has to be resolved in the problem of security sector reform if we want to be successful. In Spain, one of the most difficult tasks was precisely to resolve, to demolish the system of military justice as independent of the justice of the system and integrate the military justice inside the only possible justice in Angola that has to be one, and putting one una sala, como lo diríamos, one room or one section in the Supreme Court, one sub court in the Supreme Court for military problems. So, don't think that security sector reform is reform of the military. It's far more complex. Another remark. It's far more complex, and for this reason, takes time. Takes time, I mentioned before, because you need the support of the parliament. The military institutions or the police institutions and intelligence institutions you want to reform have to see that the civilians and the parties in this matter have a unitary position, that there is a consensus on the main lines or the guidelines, maybe not on the details, but that there is a consensus on the guidelines of the reform. That's not easy. I told you before, in Spain we had to start even educating young journalists in security matters, even educating members of the parliament on security matters, and ask to any political party, please, you know, tell us who of you will deal with security problems and will have meetings with them, courses, will send them to Brussels, to NATO, and so on and so forth. So one of the characteristics of the military dictatorships and other situations is that the field of security is not transparent at all, is really a field reserved for the military and the specialists, and the civilians have no opinion, and the problems of security have not been the object of public debate in previous occasions. So to transform the previous situation in a situation where the security problems are debated is not easy. For this reason, I think that the process takes time. Another characteristic of the Spanish case that I think that would be probably the same in all the other cases is that, you know, it's impossible to make, if I have said the security sector reform in Spain took 16 years, it's impossible to make a plan as long as a 16 years plan. So you have to have a right idea of the final target and to know that you are advancing in the right direction, but not asking the definition of the whole process. In Spain, the definition of steps ahead was made while implementing decisions of the previous step, because the reform has to be gradual. Only in certain cases, the police, but it has to be gradual. No one, civilian government knows about education, military education, of problems of military equipment, of problems of tactics, or to manage the situation from the very beginning. So it's better to think in a specific situation, in a moment, to decide the possible reform and try to implement this possible reform that will have enough support in the civilian society, in the other political parties, etc. But not thinking that you'll transform the situation in just a short period of time. So I would be more specific. Don't try to accomplish consolidating targets if you are fully in the transition or the transition period is not assured. So first of all, take the necessary steps to prevent the military and the police and the intelligence services to intervene in politics. Don't try to control them if this step has not been fulfilled or accomplished. Because, the strength of the military institution is so, of the corporate institution is so big that if you try to go beyond your possibilities will be a serious failure and could damage other steps in the future. And two more remarks and I'll finish. One, the security sector reform is not only, that's very clear in the Spanish case, the security sector reform is not only a problem of reforming laws or institutions. That's very important. And in Spain, we had a law in 1980 stating certain controls, but the definite law was not possible before 1984. So new laws, decisions, that's very important, but not only you have to change the institutions and the connection between the armed forces and the society and the parliament and the government, you need to transform the professional profile of the military. You need to transform the mentality of the military if you want a stable solution. So, and that, in the Spanish case, implied even transforming the missions of the armed forces. Franco gave to the armed forces a very first priority: control the situation inside the country. So the deployment of the military units was made to control the capitals of the province in Spain. We had to change that. We want the armed forces, we had to tell them to participate in international organizations only to assure the security, the external security of the country, to defend the country, not to control the country. So that's one thing. And the other thing is that probably you'll have to improve the professional level of the police, of the military, of the military guards, of the armed forces. So speaking foreign languages, studying, improving the level of education. We try to make an effort and to equal the studies in a military academy with the studies for the grade in a university, and taking professors from the civilian university in the military academy, and even sending military officers to the universities. So the problem of security sector reform is a problem as well of transforming, and that again takes time, the mentality of, for example, I'm thinking in Tunisia, of the members of the police. That's crucial. And the armed forces. And last, but not least, a stable and enduring situation of civilian control of the military, of democratic control of the military, of the end of the process, is only possible if and only if the military eventually accept that the best situation for them is to accept the control of the civilian government. And the acceptance of their role by the society is conditioned to the acceptance of the control of the civilian government. So this is the final change in mentality that is necessary. I'm conscious that a lot of these ideas cannot be implemented right now in the countries of the Arab Spring. But I thought that it is, can be useful to know that, the Spanish case, without the intention of giving lessons to no, is our intention, but can give insights in the directions of the comments I've made to you.